Thank you. Go ahead to the Lord of all the apostles. May the mercy of God be sent upon the reader and the listener, and upon his parents and children forever.
Brothers and sisters, therefore, knowing the fear of the Lord, we try to persuade others, but ourselves are well known to God, and I hope that we are also well known to your consciences. We are not committing ourselves to you again, but giving you an opportunity to boast about us, so that you may be able to answer those who boast in outward appearance and not in the heart. For if we are beside ourselves, it is for God. If we are in our right mind, it is for you. For the love of Christ urges us on, because we are convinced that no one has died for all. Therefore, all have died. And he died for all, so that those who live might live no longer for themselves, but for him who died and raised for them. From now on, therefore, we regard no one from a human point of view. Even though we once knew Christ from a human point of view, we know him no longer in that way. So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself in Christ, and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting the message of reconciliation to us. So we are ambassadors to Christ, since God is making his appeal through us. We entreat you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Praise be to God always.
But these are written so that you may come to believe
Michigan. So you have a special connection with Thomas. Thomas is the perfect example of how our beliefs and how we handle our beliefs in the world around us can be based on just simply where we were or where we have been. If Thomas had been with the other apostles throughout the last week, or whatever length of time it was, if he had been on the boat fishing, he would have seen Jesus and he would have been fed by him. If he had been among the many others that he appeared to right after his resurrection, he would have already believed with certainty. Sometimes we do not believe with absolute certainty because we haven't been in the right place yet. Or we were in the right place, but we weren't listening or open to what the message was. So in my mind, I constantly am reminded how important it is, even when it doesn't seem important, to have the Word of God be available to me to hear, and to give worship, and to give praise. When I was growing up, I was told to believe this, and I firmly believe that it is true. That no matter how boring the sermon might be, the Holy Spirit will make sure there is something that will benefit you if you listen. And as a kid, you know, I'm thinking, well, that was a pretty good deal. As soon as I think I heard something that was impressive and something to think about, I can go to sleep. Don't try. Unless you haven't slept all night, you have a Christian being, that's the only place you can feel the peace of God. Enjoy the ghost storm. But this is certainly an example in which it doesn't say whether he did believe or did not believe when Jesus asked the question. But he wanted it affirmed, and by the question it sounds like it. But it might be faith trying to grow. So that is to assure a person if they have questions about their faith, if they're not certain about it, that does not mean that they're evil and bad and awful. It probably means that they're thinking and pondering. And that's a very important thing. Christianity is not meant to be an absolute rigidity that doesn't develop within our spirit. You can't believe like a child does, because there's all kinds of beliefs mixed into it. And yet we are asked to believe like a child. And that sounds contradictory. But in this being said, it's to tell us that the faith that God is asking us to have in Him is meant to be filled with awe and meaning and depth, and be able to move our heart to a deeper level. And for that to happen, there's many things that have to enter into it, not just the priest's responsibility. I think all of you know that when you hear everybody sing and everybody participating and the church is full, it does something to you. You can feel the presence of God more powerfully, even though His presence, the presence of God, does not increase or decrease, but it's more available to us. Jesus was just as present to the world before Thomas touched his wounds as it was after, except that it made it more personal for him. Another aspect of Thomas and his belief in the Lord and my God is that he brought the faith to India. The Malankara Catholics, the Malabar Catholics, they hold the Tovah Shalom, common peace, sung by the Malabar and the Syriac. But the part that I think is more important on a spiritual level is that Jesus went through a locked door. And I asked myself, is there a part of my heart that I keep locked away, that I don't have to face, don't want to deal with, too painful to work through? And it's good to know that Jesus, in his love for me, and I'm including this in your life also, that he can go through that locked door. He can go through the locked heart. Whatever it is, and the manner in which we keep all the message of God out of our life. But even going through the locked door, he still allows tongues to have the choice to touch his wounds or not touch his wounds. You know, this gospel says that if everything was written down about what Jesus can do and what he has done, you couldn't write long enough and hold that big of a book that could contain it all. And as a kid, I might say, well, how many people were there? But as I matured and as I grew, I realized the reason why the earth and the world cannot contain all the works of God that Jesus has to do, because everyone that's ever going to exist, there's got to be a room in that book for them. And it's up to us whether or not we want our life written in that book as somebody who let him come to our locked heart. Whatever that might be. I find it fascinating that the healing of faith came from Paul touching his wounds. Can you imagine that, coming to a deeper faith because of a wounded Christ? Wounded by our sins, wounded by our failures, our envies, our judgments, some of our rigid thoughts. And there is anger where he says about his wounds, see what you did to me, and I'm going to remind you of what you've done to me, how horrible it was for the rest of your life. But his voice, again, peace be with you. All of this is to bring peace into our own heart and into the peace of the world. And it cannot happen if we use our wounds to justify wounding others. If that is what we chose to do in our life, our world becomes very, very small. Because we have all been wounded. You know, they say the most dangerous thing is a wounded bear. And I can think of other things that I would not want to be around if they were wounded in pain. But I think you understand what I mean. Jesus has wounds to give us hope. And in a way, to give us comfort because of the glorified body, that all of the wounds and scars that we might carry on our body and in our mind and in our heart. And some of these wounds are so deep that it's permanently changed our emotional life and our psychological life and the way we view ourselves
suffering.
That's why we have crucifixes. Not to take glory in suffering, but to take glory in the fact that suffering doesn't have to be wasted. We can waste it, but we don't have to. That we ourselves, by faith, by believing, by trying to put ourselves in as many possible situations to be exposed to this man who is willing to feed us, his very self, that somewhere in there those messages keep building up and building up. And if we can, like Thomas, say, "My Lord,
Father and the Son is the Lord of God, who has spoken through the prophets.
showering spiritual blessings upon them, and place the earth a gift, grant them life in your kingdom. As we remember our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ in his plan of salvation for us, we call upon this offering all those that we've gotten added to this day, especially Mary, the Blessed Mother of God, St. Mary, St. Joseph, and St. Jude. Remember, O God, the children of the Holy Church, our fathers and mothers, and our brothers and sisters, both the living and the departed, especially those for whom this sacrifice is offered, for Eucharist. Remember also those who share with us today in this offering.
Praise the Lord of all in heaven and earth. The powers on high.
We pray to you, O Lord. create peace throughout the world, especially in the Middle East and Africa, and an end to war and all acts of violence and hatred. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
We pray for an increase in vocations to the priesthood and consecrated life to serve the Maronite Church. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember all the saints, the fathers, the prophets, the apostles, martyrs, and confessors. Mary, the Mother of God, St. Joseph, St. Jude, St. Mary, and all the righteous and the just, through their prayers, make us worthy to stand among them. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, your praise. Those who have left us and have gone to you, especially Alfred. From the first Christian disciples to this day, they were signed with the seal of baptism and received the precious body and blood of your Son. They wait for you in your life to be whole. Raise them on the last day and in your mercy forgive their sins. For our Lord God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who is without sin, we hope to find mercy and forgiveness for our sins and for theirs.
Grant us, O God, to do the heart and forgive the sins we have committed with and without full knowledge.
Grant us pardon, God, and forgive us and the departed, so that your blessed name may be glorified in us and in all things. With the name of our Lord, our Jesus Christ, and that of your living Holy Spirit, now and forever.
As it was, is now, and shall be forever. One Holy Father, one Holy Son, one
Thank you.
St. Joseph's at the altar here. As you can see, it's breathtakingly beautiful, and we certainly appreciate that as part of a long, long legacy for us who have to beautify our church. Welcome very much to St. Joseph's. And also, we have the Lenten Supper next Sunday. Consolation of the greeting. Through your grace, fall on them, and by To the mercy of God, rest in peace.
Amen.